Hello, everyone. This is Bob and Threadbare, and welcome back to The Longest Journey. Well, it's about time we leave this area.
East Venice. There are, I think, 3 subway stops in Venice, including this one. Newport Transit System. It's not one system anymore, though. All the different lines are owned by different companies. This is the Metro line, and I believe it's run by Bocamba Mercer. Newport Waterworks. It's a strange thing to think that this whole area was once an industrial park.
It's not that strange, just look at the architecture. Anyway, it's about time we leave. Like I was saying, we are going to use the subway system a few more times before this game is over.
The gates scan everybody who goes in and out of the station and compares their genetic signature with the database. If you haven't paid your fare, the alarm goes off and the cops show up. It's a gene scanner. It, scans your genes, puts your genetic signature into a database, and allows you through all corresponding gates.
All right. So how long, April?
I'll get a weekly pass, just in case. It's a small camera. Let's see. According to the instructions, I push a button with a stylized hand, wave my cash card in front of the round thingy, and then stand still for a few seconds. Good. Stand still.
And this is why you need to charge your cash card with money.
$15 subtracted from cash card. You are now free to travel on all Metroline subways for exactly 1 week. And remember, genetic forgery is a federal crime. Keep your genes clean. Have a nice day.
Interesting that they can get gene samples without drawing blood or spit. Or hair.
There's a high-voltage cable running parallel with the rail, and something's gotten stuck between them. It looks like a large iron key.
Oh, that iron key. Silliest puzzle in the game.
I'd have to get down there to reach it with my hands, but with that frayed high-voltage cable. I didn't brush my teeth this morning just so I could be fried bacon with a pretty smile. I'll have to find some other way to get the key.
Anything else? Guess I'll just have to wait for the train then. But yeah, I've already gotten started solving that particular puzzle, but I'll be doing the most of it in the next video, the one after this one. Not much going on.
The screen really is ubiquitous. There's no escape anywhere.
I guess we're going west.
Newport Transit Systems. Another victim of Amethyn. Poor guy's drugged out on Amethyn. They say the first motor function to suffer is always rhythm. Big sound from such a small box.
Wow, they've still got boom boxes 200 years in the future?
The Roma Gallery. Maybe one day I'll have my own show here.
Man, such a retro design. Was it retro for 2000 or not? Certainly gone out of fashion by then.
Hello, sir. Sir? I'll just leave my ticket here then, shall I? Yes. Yes, I guess I'll do that. Neat. Slow day, I guess.
All right.
There's absolutely nothing out there. Nothing. Oh, there's a city, an entire world even. But nothing.
Such an artist thing to say.
It's a pointy-edged swan. It's a short, nude creature with a snout. Very inspiring.
I think some of these pictures were on that poster.
For the life of me, I can't figure out why Cortez wants to meet me. Come to think of it, why do I want to meet him?
Because you had a daytime hallucination earlier today.
About time you showed up.
About time? I spent more than...
Mira, this painting. Right here. Look.
You brought me all the way down here to look at a painting?
Yes, but there's more. Just look at it.
He's not gonna let this go.
Who's the artist?
A boy named Warren Hughes. Not so long ago, I knew him and his family quite well, but he does not paint anymore.
What am I looking for?
What do you see?
Oh God, it's this kind of question.
I see a statement on loss. The guy, he's hugging a girl, and by all rights, he should be happy, but he's not. He's probably already mourning the loss of her, even though that's still somewhere in his future.
Statements? Who cares about statements? Tell me what you see.
I see a guy hugging a girl.
And?
They're probably boyfriend-girlfriend, and she's dumping him. He looks really depressed.
Yes, yes. Forget the story. What do you see?
I see an oil painting of two humans locked in an embrace.
That's all you see? But there's so much more. Look. Look.
I see art.
Art, yes. And beyond that. Beyond art.
Beyond art. Honestly.
Illusion.
Skill and imagination allow the artist to create an illusion, but that is only skin deep. Beneath the illusion, what else is there?
Truth?
Truth. Exactly. A deeper truth. This painting, this particular work of art, speaks a deeper truth. It has a soul.
How can a painting have a soul?
It has a soul because it has an identity. It has a heart. The memory of this painting will survive beyond this moment. It will linger in your mind, become part of the tapestry of your subconscious. It has made a lasting impression on you, and you're not quite sure why.
It's just a painting by some kid. It's not as if it's a Picasso or a Monet.
Now you're arguing technique. Not every painting by Van Gogh or Michelangelo is real art either, although they all demonstrate great technique and craftsmanship. And the scribbled drawings of a five-year-old child are rarely technically impressive, but they may still have a soul. They may still be real art.
So you're saying real art is not defined by the skill of the artist? Then what is art, if just anybody can create something more real than artists who've spent their entire lives developing their skills?
Art is still the work of artists. And skill, craftsmanship, technique, those things are critical to the success of an artist's work. But alone, those things are merely pretense. For something to be real, to be truthful, the artist must transfer, shift part of him or herself into the work, to transcend the illusion and reach for the truth of art.
And what is the truth of art?
Who knows? I've been asking myself that question for years.
Excuse me? You don't even know? And what's all this about all the questions and lectures on truth and illusion? For that matter, why did you ask me to come down here in the first place?
Because...
Actually, you didn't even ask me to come down. I spent my entire afternoon traveling all over Venice, deciphering a cryptic message, spending money I don't have on a subway ticket, only to have to stand here and listen to...
You saw something this afternoon. A waking dream, and you can't explain it. That's why you are here, isn't it?
Not even gonna ask how he knows.
Didn't I tell you to stay out of my personal life?
Yes. Yes, you did. But I chose not to listen. My point about art and truth is this, April. Some things look real, but are not. And other things may appear to be of no consequence at all, but are in fact invaluable. Like Warren's painting here, and your dreams. There is both truth and illusion in dreams, and in the images they create. The problem is in sorting the one from the other.
You're telling me my dreams are true?
I'm telling you there are things afoot, and that you need help in sorting the truth from the illusions. My help.
Well, that figures.
Good. I was hoping you'd understand.
No. Actually, I didn't understand a single word. You talk about art, and truth, and dreams, and illusions, and I still don't understand what it all has to do with me. There are things happening, yes, and I came here because I thought maybe you're crazy enough to believe me, to help me, I don't know, sort through the debris and come up with the plausible explanation. But no, you tell me my dreams might be true, that I need your help, and that there are things afoot. I mean, who says afoot? I've never heard anybody use the word before. There are things afoot.
Está bien. I understand your reluctance to believe me, señorita. But I cannot convince you here, now. Meet me tomorrow.
What?
Meet me tomorrow, and I will tell you everything.
Not again, no way.
But you will. Because you are compelled to do so by your own curiosity. Because you are drawn to mystery. And because despite your skepticism, you believe I have the answer to all your questions, yes?
No. No, I don't care. I just want to have a normal life. No nightmares, no visions, no strangers telling me that things are afoot. Comprende, amigo?
Ay, Dios mío. Is that the time? I've got to run, señorita Ryan. I'll see you tomorrow, then.
I said...
Goodbye.
Cortez is a real art snob. But honestly, I can't say I completely disagree with him. Because I kind of feel the same way about the works of Mozart. Technically impressive, but not much soul. I mean, some of the stuff, yeah. Yeah, definitely, but not all of it. Not everything that's popular really resonates with me. But yeah, to answer his burning, eternal question, art is an attempt to communicate using more than just words. That's it. Anyway, not much left to do. So I suppose, yeah.
It's a plaque commemorating the Venice Massacre of 2109. It reads, "In honor of those who died defending our right to live."
Is it just 100 years? Man, I cannot keep track. I did not memorize the date this game takes place on. But yeah, nothing else to do, so let's head back home and... Oh, hey! Mickey's here. Hi, Mickey.
Mickey's not usually the sit-in-front-of-the-screen type of gal, unlike Fiona. She's always working on something around the house. I guess that's why they're such a great couple.
Let's talk with Mickey.
What's going on, Mickey?
Well, the water's been fixed, so you can take a hot shower if you want.
I smell that bad.
I kind of like taking a cold shower in this heat.
You can still take a cold shower if you really want to. I'm just saying the hot water's there. You know, In case you need it.
Thanks, Mickey.
Yeah.
What was wrong with the pipes?
They're just old, like all of Venice. They're really old. Twice a year, every year, I have to spend a half a day freezing my ass off down in the canal performing emergency surgery on the pipes. Not that I don't love doing it, especially when my so-called partner's curled up on the sofa watching soaps all day long.
I'll talk to you later, Mickey.
Yeah.
She's not much of a talker. Not like Fiona.
Have you been sitting here all day?
Pretty much, darling. I feel like a vegetable. How was your day, then?
Mixed bag.
It's been a weird day.
How so?
Well, you know how some mornings you wake up, but you're not sure if you're really awake or if you're still just dreaming?
I feel like that every morning, darling. A pot of black coffee cures that in a flash.
That's how I've been feeling all day. Like I said, it's been a weird day. How was yours?
Exceedingly ordinary. Almost depressingly so. I poked my head out of the door once for about a second, but thought better of it.
What are you watching?
Nothing special. We were thinking about watching a movie later, though.
Yeah, which one?
They have quite a few new releases out. Did you ever see Victory Hotel?
No. Is it good?
That's what they say. So we might catch that one.
Can I ask you a few questions?
Why, certainly, darling. About what?
Well, they've got something new.
What do you think of Cortez?
I'm not sure what you mean, darling.
Do you think he's a little creepy?
Oh, he's harmless. That old hippie's been drugged up for 50 years, and he's not likely to come down any time soon. Mickey likes him, but I'm not a big fan. But what can I do? He just sits outside the building, smoking or reading a book. He doesn't harm anyone.
How long has he been around?
Oh, I don't know. A year, maybe? He just showed up one day, and he hasn't left since.
He never leaves his spot?
He sleeps and eats, obviously. And sometimes he goes to some revival cinema uptown. Says that second to reading, old movies are his greatest passion.
What else can you tell me about Cortez?
One word I wouldn't use to describe him is lucid. He's always on about some bollocks idea, and you'd never know from listening to him that he's got any sense at all. People say he's quite sharp, though, quite intelligent. Well-read, multilingual, and he's travelled all over the world, apparently, but still completely bonkers, if you ask me.
Tell me some more precise... Thanks for the information.
I'm glad I...
Alright, just wanted to check.
Thanks for your help, Fiona.
You're welcome, darling. Why don't you sit down and watch a movie with us, April?
You know what? That sounds like an excellent idea.
Yeah, she's the only one who doesn't seem to get Cortez. And yet she says that she's an excellent judge of character. Go figure. I'm not sure this is Victory Hotel. Well, shit. The walls between realities are crumbling. Oh, no, there they are. Okay, so, what if I said I did want to work tonight? I would have been able to spend the night with Fiona.
I'm all scrubbed and ready to work, sir.
You'll be on the floor tonight, honey. Start taking orders.
I won't be doing this for every time the game branches. I mean, it always comes back together afterwards. But for big moments like this, I figure I should show you both versions. Oh hey, I saw a statue of you earlier.
And get him to explain what the hell's going on. Insane or not, he's the only person I can talk to about this.
All right, we're just going to continue on under the assumption that April spent the evening with the Fiona and Mickey. So, how's that rubber ducky doing? Well, you know something that, the seagulls like is bread. So clearly what we need to do here is put bread on the rubber ducky so that the seagull will pick at the bread and poke a hole. Makes sense to me.
Clank? The grill is almost completely submerged in that, and I use this term quite liberally, liquid.
Now that we've knocked the clothesline completely free, we can use that chain to collect it.
It's a plastic-coated clothesline.
I did say we'd be doing most of this in the next video, but, I could do this part in this one.
That's Zach's room. I've never been in there. Nobody home.
I think that's Emma's room, just behind the big pipe thing. The one that talked to us in the second video.
It's Fiona. Did your tongue stick to the window pane again, Fiona?
Please tell me last night was a dream, April.
Yeah.
I don't know what it was.
I wish there was an explanation. But both you and Mickey... We all saw the same thing, didn't we? Not a dream, not a hallucination, but what?
Weird things have been happening lately.
I have noticed. This isn't the first time.
What other weird things have happened lately?
Little things, like movement in the corner of your eye that's gone when you turn your head. And noises. The kind you're not supposed to hear in the city. Animal noises. Wild animals. And once, this was very early in the morning, mind, a few days ago, I looked down into the canal and saw what looked like an underwater city. But as I looked at it, it dissolved into ripples of water.
Scary.
You're telling me, darling. I'm scared of cockroaches, for God's sake. What do you think this does to my nerves?
Have you seen Cortez today?
No, darling. I don't think he's around.
Do you have any idea where Cortez is?
Sorry, he could be anywhere. Well, he does enjoy going uptown to watch old movies in some revival cinema, but where that is, I wouldn't know.
Who'd know?
Perhaps Zach. He is, after all, the self-appointed film expert around here. You should talk to him, darling.
Great. Zach, my very best friend in the whole wide world. Could you tell Cortez I'm looking for him?
Certainly, darling. if I happen to see him.
Thanks. I have to get going.
Take care of yourself out there, darling.
Well, shit, now we have to talk to Zach. This is so humiliating. But yeah, obviously, she would explain what happened last night if you weren't there. But it does happen either way. Wherever April is.
I never imagined I'd be doing this in a million years.
Well, well, what do you know? The princess comes knocking after all.
Sigh.
Don't get your hopes up.
I think you're the one who's got her hopes up, babe. And you better hope I don't slam this door in your face.
Just do me one favor first, okay?
Well, give me a reason to, babe.
A reason? You want a reason? Okay. What about a date?
Yeah. Good. Tonight.
Sure. Tonight. I'll meet you at the pavilion, was it?
And, are you gonna put out?
What?
Well, I mean, if I'm gonna give you my VIP passes and my pills, babe, I just gotta know if it'll be worth it or not. You on?
We'll see, Zach.
Just don't do a Houdini and vanish on me, babe. If you're a no-show and I wait around for you all night, I end up looking like an asshole, and that wouldn't make me very happy.
I'll be a good girl and show.
Smart. So, what do you want to know?
Where can I find a theater that shows old movies?
There are quite a few that do, but only one that runs optical stock. I figure that's the one you want, yeah?
Why?
'Cause that's where Cortez likes to hang out, and I'm guessing you're trying to hook up with him.
No. I just need to do some research for a painting.
Babe, I'm not a moron. I see you guys together. What are you, his lover? Do shriveled old weirdos turn you on? What is it, his accent? His acute lack of fashion?
It's not what you think.
Whatever. Hey, like I give a shit? You're with me tonight. By tomorrow morning, I don't think you'll find that old creep so appealing anymore.
So, where is Cortez?
When he's not outside reading or whatever the hell he does, he's usually at the Mercury Theater. They show old movies on real celluloid stock through a projector, like in the fucking Middle Ages.
Where's this theater located?
I don't remember the street it's on. It's been ages since I was there last. But you'll find it if you head out the East Gateway from Metro Circle. It's close to the Radio Power Building, and there are tons of adult stores in the area. Actually, if you're not too busy, you could pick up something for us to watch tonight. Something really filthy.
Zach, I don't think...
Hey, whatever. I was just kidding, yeah? Babe, you got a major bug up your ass. Get a fucking sense of humor, yeah?
I'll keep that in mind. Thanks for the tip and the info.
Just be at the pavilion by 10, okay? I don't like waiting around for babies like you. Got a million better things to do. And it wouldn't be a good idea for you to ditch me. Not a good idea at all.
Getting all defensive about your porn there, huh, buddy? Yeah, you cannot click on that door over there. Too bad. Well, we made a date, and we found a theater. If the date wasn't with Zach, I'd say we did pretty good today. So, I'm doing something new for this LP. See, I own so many fantasy and science fiction books and movies and TV shows that I could do this whole thing without having to buy anything new. It's crazy. So what I've done is let my patrons request a Bobbin's Choice, where I choose something that may or may not be portal-related, but is what I consider a very good speculative fiction work. I bring this up because patron Cronish has requested a Bobbin's Choice, and so today I'll be taking a look at one of my all-time favorite books, Firebird by Mercedes Lackey. About the author. Mercedes Lackey is a prolific author of fantasy novels, who was born in Chicago in 1950. She had a fairly ordinary childhood, at least by her reckoning, and she first got into science fiction and fantasy thanks to James H. Schmitz and Andre Norton, the latter of whom was a woman author who wrote under masculine pen names. Norton was also one of the great Golden Age authors, but I'm getting off topic. Lackey graduated from Purdue University in 1972. During her time at college, she discovered some fellow science fiction fans and started submitting some of her own works to what are called fanzines, amateur magazines that would publish fan fiction and original stories that, for whatever reason, aren't picked up by a professional magazine. She also started writing science fiction folk music. From there, she transitioned to writing fantasy stories, and that became her genre of choice by the time she started submitting her stories to the professionals. Before she became a professional author, Lackey worked in computer programming with American Airlines, moving to Tulsa, Oklahoma in the process. These days, she lives with her husband just outside of town, and sometimes helps rehabilitate raptors, which is to say birds of prey, not human-sized dinosaurs. Lackey's most famous book series would have to be the Valdemar universe. The books center on a kingdom called Valdemar and the uniquely intelligent horses they call companions. Each companion chooses a human, thenceforth called a herald, and through their connection, the herald gains certain magical abilities. Now, as you can probably guess, the books are primarily aimed at girls in their horses are amazing phase, but thanks to Lackey's experience living in a rural area and interacting with actual farm animals, her books are a lot more grounded in reality than they have to be. If you're curious about the Valdemar universe, but you're a grown-ass man such as myself, I'd recommend starting with the books Exile's Honor and Exile's Valor, which also happen to be about a grown-ass man who doesn't really get this whole magical horses stuff at first. And if that doesn't apply to you, then the Eros trilogy is a good place to start, since that's the first Valdemar trilogy Lackey wrote. Mercedes Lackey has also written a lot of books outside of the Valdemar universe, including a collaboration with Andre Norton called The Half-Blood Chronicles. More than a few of her novels are mature adaptations of fairy tales, and while most of them take place in a setting called the 500 Kingdoms, today's book, Firebird, is a standalone story published in 1996 that takes place in its own setting. Firebird has two primary influences: the ballet The Firebird by Igor Stravinsky and the Brothers Grimm story, The Golden Bird. That being said, Firebird is a fairly thick novel, and it doesn't shy away from involving other mythical Russian creatures and characters. Pretty much the only big one who doesn't show up is old Baba Yaga. Why am I telling you this? I should be telling you this story. Ilya Ivanovich is the son of Tsar Ivan, a man who is not as great as the great Tsar, but who has more land than any of his boyar neighbors. He also has the unique fortune of having 8 adult children, all sons. And while some tsars would use his sons to create a powerful army, Tsar Ivan is so paranoid that he has refused to name an inheritor and encourages his sons to fight each other for his favor. As a result, most of them have grown up to be malicious, backstabbing thugs. Most of them. Ilya is the exception, probably because he was the only son of Ivan's second wife, or possibly because he grew up under the tutelage of 3 exceptional people: the supremely competent Mother Galina, head of the palace dairy, the Orthodox priest, Father Mikhail, and the Slavic shaman, Ruslan. Ruslan and Mikhail have formed an odd alliance. Ivan hates both religions, and pretty much anything that isn't money or land, but he can't get rid of either of them without pissing someone off, and so he ignores them instead. Between the 3 of them, Ivan learns how to be a good person, he learns how to read, and he learns all about the Orthodox saints and Slavic spirits, like the Bannock and the Domovoy. His brothers soon realize that Ilya is growing up smarter than them, and so he also learns how to fight, and how to sneak around the palace, so that his brothers won't beat him up. After that, though, they start ganging up on him, and the beatings slowly grow more serious. Ivan sees this happening, but he turns a blind eye because one less son would mean one less person plotting his own demise, at least as he sees it. Ilya sees it differently, though, because he would gladly run away from this toxic family if he thought he could actually get away without getting caught. After a few chapters to introduce everyone, the plot begins on the night Ilya spends with a particularly fetching dairymaid. During the night, someone managed to slip into Ivan's private cherry orchard, past sleeping guards, and take all the ripe cherries right off the trees. Ivan is particularly fond of cherries, you see, and so he has a guarded grove of rare late-fruiting cherry trees. Now, the cherries aren't worth much, but the theft means that someone is spitting in Ivan's face. So, as the thefts continue night after night, and the guards fall asleep every single time, Ivan gets angrier and angrier. Ilya's brothers are convinced he's somehow to blame because maybe he has magic powers since he's so smart, and they give him a particularly thorough beating. Fortunately, though, the thefts continue during Ilya's recuperation, so even Ivan can't suspect him after that. In fact, when Ilya finally becomes well enough to return to the palace dining hall, Ivan makes an announcement. Each of his sons will take turns guarding the cherry trees from oldest to youngest. If any of them manage to catch the thief, that son will become Ivan's heir. Ilya is intrigued by this, not because he wants to become the heir, heaven forbid, but because the thief able to evade Ivan's guards for this long might be able to help him escape. So he sneaks into the cherry grove on the first night, but whatever power makes the guards fall asleep manages to catch him too. On the second night, he returns to the grove, but fills his clothing with pins to keep him awake. This helps him fight off the magical song that puts people to sleep, and he soon comes face to face with the Firebird, a magical creature that is sometimes a bird of fiery wings, sometimes a beautiful maiden with golden hair, and sometimes a bit of both at once. Ilya says nothing of what he saw to anyone, even though he can't stop dreaming about the Firebird. Meanwhile, the second son, Pietor, conspires with the stable hands so that he can insult Ivan to his face and successfully run off. Ilya is jealous, but his other brothers are angry. They beat Ilya to within an inch of his life, leave him in the family crypt to die, and since Ilya has seen the Firebird, he can now see his ancestors' ghosts as they each take turns berating or admonishing him. Fortunately, Mikhail and Ruslan find Ilya before he bleeds out. The two old men are worried for Ilya. His brothers really tried to kill him this time, and they'll try again when he comes out of hiding. So they come up with a plan. Ilya will pretend to be a fool, completely witless, and therefore no danger to either his father or his brothers. He fully adapts to his new role just as winter sets in. And meanwhile, the Firebird rewards his silence by leaving him a magical cherry that lets him understand animals. During the winter, Ilya's brothers play a cruel prank on him by tying his legs to the stirrups of a horse and taking him out on a boar hunt. Fortunately, the horse in question is a descendant of Nightwind, a mythical horse of great intelligence and power. And so, the horse only pretends to spook, and the two spend most of the day having a nice walk through the woods. Well, at least until the two come across a wounded boar that gores the horse and runs off. With his last request, the horse asks Ilya to cut off part of his tail hair and make a bracelet. According to him, this should help counter the curse of bad luck that's been affecting Ilya ever since he saw the Firebird. Ilya cuts the hair and starts wandering through the darkening woods. He happens across an unseasonably warm lake and a young woman. But the woman turns out to be a Rusalka, an evil water spirit who drowns the unwary. Ilya escapes with the help of the horse's spirit, and in the process he frees a nightingale that the Rusalka was going to eat. The next day, he happens across a hedge maze that's identical to the maze in Ilya's family tomb. This is because the man at the center of the maze is Yasha, a huntmaster who worked for Tsar Ivan's father before he retired. Ilya gets some food, clothing, and equipment from Yasha, and since he has no reason to go back home, he decides to set out and seek his fortune. The first thing Ilya does is free a fox from a fallen log, and then he comes across a maze with impossibly tall stone walls. The nightingale from earlier shows up to lead him through, and as he approaches the center, it once again grows unseasonably warm. At its center, Ilya is astonished to find an immense palace with acres of gardens and orchards surrounding it. Ilya explores the grounds until he comes across a familiar light in an apple orchard. It's the Firebird again, and while Ivan couldn't hold her, the owner of this estate is a powerful and immortal sorcerer called the Katsche. When the Firebird sees Ilya, she lifts her curse and urges him to leave. But Ilya spots a mechanical release on the magical net and uses it to free her. He then grabs the Firebird by the wrists and refuses to let go until she agrees to help him defeat the Katschai. The Firebird has been observing the Katschai for some time, so she explains that he routinely kidnaps the most beautiful women from around the world and keeps them until he tires of them. Never touches them, though, because he finds no pleasure in anything but greed. He took out his heart and sealed it in stone. And he put that stone in a diamond. He put that diamond in a duck. He put the duck in a hare. He put the hare in a locked chest. He put the chest on the highest branch of an impossibly tall oak tree. And finally, he set a mechanical dragon to guard the tree. After explaining all of this, the Firebird leaves. But first, she gives Ilya a feather that he can use to summon her by waving it over his head 3 times. Ilya sneaks over to the maiden's garden and instantly falls in love with the most beautiful of the 12, Tatiana. Turns out she was the Katschai's first victim. He came to her father's kingdom, killed him, transformed his servants into monsters, and then turned his castle into the magic palace. Ilya swears to rescue her, but then the Katschai shows up. Fortunately, Ilya has been playing a fool for months now, and so he falls into an old routine, and the Katschai decides to make him scrub dishes in the kitchen. Ilya quickly gets out of kitchen duty and spends several weeks scouting out the palace. He befriends the monster gardener, and that lets him find a garden full of the challengers that the Katschai turned into statues. And he discovers the dragon garden with a giant oak tree. And then he gets caught and teleported out of the palace. It's still the dead of winter outside the Katschai's influence, but the warmth of the Firebird's feather keeps Ilya from freezing to death. The fox finds him and leads him back into the labyrinth, and once he recovers, Ilya waves the Firebird feather and calls her over. The Firebird again warns Ilya to abandon his plan, but he says that he can't help but do this for love, even though he knows he shouldn't. Oddly enough, the Firebird says that she knows what he means. The three come up with a plan to get the Katschai's heart. Ilya and the fox bug the dragon until the Katschai turns it off in frustration. The Firebird guides Ilya up the tree, and between the three of them, they manage to destroy the box, kill the hare and the duck, get the diamond, and then... Then the Katschai's forces dogpile Ilya, and the Firebird runs away. The Katschai doesn't kill Ilya immediately, but that's because he wants to know how Ilya found out about his heart. He has his monsters beat Ilya, but then a bunch of things happen at once. Ilya escapes the monsters, the maidens distract the Katschai, and then Ilya summons the Firebird, who smashes in through the window and sings her song of sleep. The Katschai is able to counter her magic, but she keeps him busy long enough for Ilya to grab the diamond and smash it, killing the Katschai and undoing all of his enchantments. Ilya has become the hero of the kingdom. The statues all come back to life, including Ilya's wayward brother, Pietor, and all of them pledge their loyalty or friendship. Many of them pair off with the maidens, and of course Ilya gets both Tatiana and her kingdom. But this ending isn't as happy as it first sounds. Tatiana, for one, is spoiled rotten thanks to her father and thanks to living with the Katschai. And when Ilya isn't planning a massive 12 weddings at once, he's having to fulfill his fiancée's whims and deal with her tantrums. The magic in his life seems to have gone, and even the animals have stopped speaking to him. And just to cap everything off, Ilya realizes only now that while he was infatuated with Tatiana, he was in love with the Firebird. But then, on the day of the wedding, the fox and the nightingale show back up. They suggest to Ilya that he should go get some big, strong friends and go visit his bride-to-be. So he does so, and Ilya discovers Tatiana and his brother Pietor together in her bed. Ilya is overjoyed that he has an excuse to get the hell out of there, But for appearance's sake, he pretends to be outraged as he storms off, orders a horse and some provisions, and gallops off with the fox and the nightingale. Once he's away from the palace, Ilya pulls out the Firebird feather that he always kept under his shirt. The Firebird appears and embraces him, and as the four of them start the journey to the Firebird's mythical palace, the fox says, "And we all lived happily ever after." The analysis. I'm just going to go ahead and admit this. You're probably going to notice a theme among my personal picks, both Portal and otherwise, of works that turn myths and fairy tales on their heads. There's something about that blending of old and new ideas, taking the best thoughts from 100 different sources, that really appeals to me. Old stories stick around for a reason, you know? And it's not just because they closely fit the hero's journey arc. So what do we have in this book? We have a protagonist named after one mythical Russian hero, and his father named after another mythical Russian hero, but their household is so toxic that Ilya's brothers try to murder him, and Ivan only gets mad because they failed. Ilya gains the ability to speak to animals, but for the most part they're about as dumb as they are in real life. Dogs just think in terms of food, petting, and pack dynamics, and they have no sense of time outside of just now and forever. Cats are better able to think for themselves, but they're also very selfish. The Katschai is this monumentally powerful sorcerer, and his life is set up as this ultimate tragedy of power. He sold his soul and encased his heart in stone, so while he's greedy for everything and he has the power to take it, he lacks any ability to enjoy it. And yet he also has some very human weaknesses. He keeps his minions stupid so they can't plot against him, but that makes them easy to fool for someone good at fooling. And even the Katschai falls for Ilya's antics on two occasions. He also gets very frustrated when his dragon apparently keeps screaming at nothing, and Ilya takes advantage of his arrogance throughout the story. And then, of course, there's the love story. The signs are all there, all throughout the novel, pointing in the right direction. But it takes Ilya, and possibly the reader, until the end to see the truth. Ilya loves the adventure, not the prize he gets when it ends. Well, it's dangerous, sure, but so is life at home. And with the adventure, Ilya gets the freedom to set his own goals, to be the man he wants to be, to see things he's never seen before, and to do things that no one else has accomplished. The Firebird represents all of that. She lives that life. And unlike Tatiana, she loves him back. And so it's no wonder that she is the one he truly loves. As the two say at the end, the Firebird would rather never fly again than be without Ilya. And Ilya would never ask her to make that choice. This is what I was talking about with Enchanted. Firebird deconstructs the shapes of the old myths, and in this case an old ballet, but it doesn't deconstruct the meanings behind them. This is a book about freedom, about looking past your own nose so that you can see the true beauty of the world. And it's about understanding the true nature of love. This is one of my favorite books of all time. I read through it twice the first time I found it, and I definitely recommend that you read it. Thanks for joining me again for today's book review, and I hope I'll see you next time when we turn around. Look at what you see!